Now we are going to discuss the displacement of fringes when a thin sheet of a particular material is placed in the path of the light which is coming from one of the sources. So we already know in case of Young's double slit experiment, we had two coherent sources, that is we had two slits which behaved as two coherent sources. So the light from those sources was made to interfere on the whole screen, and hence an interference pattern was observed on the screen. Now capital O, this was the center of the screen, and also the central fringe of the interference pattern was observed at capital O. So capital O was the center of the screen, and also the central fringe also was observed at this particular point. So small d is the distance between the two slits, and capital D is the distance between the slits and the screen. So we have taken an observation point capital P. So the light from the two sources S1 and S2 is made to interfere at this capital point, capital P point. So the difference over here is that in the simple Young's double slit experiment, we just made the light to interfere as it is. We did not introduce any material in the path of the light which was coming from the sources. So in this article, now we will introduce a thin material, that is a material whose thickness was very less and whose refractive index is given by small l. So the small t is the thickness of the sheet and small n is the refractive index of the material. So this kind of plate is particularly, it is introduced in the path of one of the sources. So the light which is coming from S1 source, it will have to pass through this sheet and then it will fall on the screen. Whereas the light which is coming from S2 source, it will fall on the screen as it is, or it will fall on the screen directly. Whereas the light which is coming from S1 source, it will have to pass through this particular sheet which is of thickness t and refractive index small n. So let t be the thickness of the plate and small n is its refractive index. So now we can clearly see from this diagram, we can clearly see that the light from S1, it has to pass through this particular plate and then it falls on capital P. So this light ray, which is the first light ray, and this is the second light ray. So capital P is any random observation point. So this light ray, first light ray, it will travel the distance S1P minus T. S1P, which was the original distance. So the distance which is traveled by the light, first light ray, that is S1P minus T, that distance is traveled in air, whereas the distance small t is traveled by this light ray in this particular material. So there are two distances which are traveled by the first light ray. First is S1P minus T, which is the distance traveled in the air medium, and the thickness T, or the distance T, which is traveled by this same light ray inside the material of the plate. So the time required, for the light to reach from S1 to point capital P, that will be given by, is given by, so S1P minus T is the distance which is traveled in the air medium, and T is the distance which is traveled by the same light ray in the medium of the plate. So we have to find the time which is taken by this first light ray to reach from S1 to capital P. So to find the time, we know that time is equal to distance upon, this is equal to, time is given by distance upon the velocity. So we know that this distance is traveled by the light in the air medium or in the vacuum. So in the case of vacuum or air medium, the velocity of light is taken as c. That is, it is given by c, which is equal to 3 into 10 raised to power 8 meters per second. So to find time, we know the distances. So we divide this distance by small c. This will give us the time which is taken by the first light ray to travel in the air medium, and the time which is taken by the same light ray to travel inside this plate of thickness small t. So this velocity, the velocity of light inside this plate, let's say that is given by v. So c is the velocity of the light in the vacuum or in the air, and v is the velocity of the light ray inside the plate. So we know the formula or the relation of refractive index. So refractive index n, that is given by c divided by v. So c is the velocity of light and v is the velocity of the light ray inside the medium whose refractive index is given by small n. So this is the relation. So the distance traveled in the plate is given by small t. So the time taken by the light to travel in this particular plate will be given by t divided by the velocity of the light inside the plate, which is given by v. So the sum of both times, when we do sum of both times, so that will give us the total time which is taken by the light to reach from S1 to capital P. So this is the time which is taken by the first light ray to travel from S1 to capital P. So on solving, we put the value of V. So V will be given by C by small n. So we will put the value of small v, that will be S1 P minus T divided by C as it is, plus T divided by C by n. So that will give you n T by C. So on taking 1 by c common outside this bracket, this will give us S1 P minus T plus n T. And on solving, that will give us 1 by c S1 P as it is. Now we will take T outside, that will give us n minus 1 times T. So this is the time which is taken by the light to travel from S1 source to the observation point capital P. So this first equation, it shows that when we introduce this thin plate in the path of the light ray, so then the effective optical path of the light, it increases by this particular factor. Now if we take the previous case when there was no plate which was present, that is the light from S1 was also allowed to fall on capital P directly, and the light from S2 was also allowed to fall on the point capital P as it is directly. So in that case, when there is no plate which is introduced, in that case the path which is traveled by the light from S1 to capital P, so that time will be given by simply the distance, which is S1 P divided by the velocity of light in the medium, and the medium was just the air or the vacuum, so that will be S1 P divided by C. So this is the time which is taken by the light from S1 to reach point capital P when there is no glass plate introduced. So this is the time in that case. Now when we have introduced this glass plate in the path of the first ray, so now the formula of time, here we have an extra factor or extra distance which is traveled by the light, which is n minus 1 times t. So you can compare these both equations. So here we have only this extra term, which is n minus 1 times t, which means that By introducing by introducing the thin plate, the effective optical path of the light it increases by the factor n minus 1 times t. So the path of the light, effective optical path, it will increase by this factor when we introduce the thin plate in the path of the, this difference in the optical path is the only reason why the interference pattern, it shifts or it changes its position when a thin plate is introduced. So when no plate is introduced, we get an interference pattern, but on the introduction of this thin plate, we see that the optical path of the light, it changes, that is, it is not equal to S1P, now it is S1P plus n minus 1 times t. So in this case, now the interference pattern which will be observed on the screen, it will get shifted. And let's say capital O, this is the center of the screen, and when there is no thin plate, if there is no thin plate, then capital O will be the position where the central fringe will occur. But when this thin plate is introduced, the central fringe, the central maxima that we get at capital O, now we will not get at capital O on the introduction of thin plate. The position of the central fringe, it will get shifted to another point, let's say that is capital O prime. So this is the only reason why the central fringe, it gets shifted, because the effective optical path, it increases by this particular factor. Now we know that the central fringe, it occurs at a particular point. So if there is no thin plate which is introduced, we know that the central fringe of the light, it will occur at capital O, because in that condition S1O will be equal to S2O, because there is no thin plate, the light from S1 will directly fall at capital O, and from S2 it will fall directly at capital O. So the central fringe, we know that it occurs at a point where the path difference between the two lights is equal to zero. So in the earlier case, when there is no introduction of this thin plate, so this condition occurs at the center of the screen itself. That is, at the center of the screen, we know that S1O will be equal to S2O. So hence, the path difference of the two lights will be equal to zero, and hence capital O, which is the center of the screen, so this is the same position where the central fringe occurs. But now in this case, when a thin plate is introduced, now the optical path of the light, it increases by this particular factor. And now the light which is reaching at capital O point, the distance traveled by this light will not be equal to S2O, because now the light will travel distance which will be S1O plus n minus 1 times t. So the distance which is traveled by the light from S1 to capital O will be equal to S1P plus S1O plus n minus 1 times t, whereas the distance traveled by the light from S2 to point capital O will be the same, which will be S2O. So we can clearly see that S1, this optical path, will not be equal to this optical path which is traveled by the second ray. So hence we will not get a central fringe at capital O point. Now the central fringe, it will get shifted to another point, let's say that is capital O prime, and at this particular point, the optical path which will be traveled by the two light rays, that is coming from S1 which is reaching at capital O prime, and the light ray which is coming from S2 and reaching at point capital O prime. So these two light rays will have the same optical path, and hence the path difference between the two light rays will be equal to zero, and hence the central fringe will occur at capital O prime. So the distance which is traveled by the light from S1 to capital O prime when there is thin plate introduced. So the path which will be traveled by the light will be equal to S1 O prime plus n minus 1 times t. Just we have to change. Now we are looking at capital O prime. Earlier we looked at capital P, which was a random observation point. So we had the optical path traveled by the light from S1 that was equal to S1P plus n minus 1 times t. Now we are looking at another observation point, which is capital O prime. So in this case also we will have the same optical path, but now we are talking about O prime instead of capital P. So the optical path of the light will be S1 O prime plus n minus 1 times t. So this will be the optical path which will be traveled by the light which is coming from S1 and reaching point capital O prime, and this will be equal to S2 O prime, because we are just saying, we are supposing that capital O prime is the point where the central fringe gets shifted. Earlier it was on capital O, now on the introduction of this plate, this central fringe, it gets shifted to another point which is capital O prime. And now at O prime, the optical paths which will be traveled by the two light rays coming from the two slits, that will be equal to each other. So the optical path traveled by the light coming from S1 and reaching point capital O prime is given by this formula, and the optical path which is traveled by the light coming from S2 and reaching directly at O prime will be equal to simply S2 O prime. So from here we can say that S2 O prime minus S1 O prime, S2 O prime minus S1 O prime will be equal to n minus 1 times t. So this is the difference between the, now this is the geometrical path, this is simply the geometrical path, S1 O prime and S2 O prime, these are the simply the geometrical paths. So the difference between the two geometrical paths will be equal to n minus 1 times t. Now in the article of Young's double slit experiment, we saw that S2P minus S1P, we did the whole derivation, and we saw that S2P minus S1P, it came approximately equal to D by capital D times YN. So in this case, we had two slits and there was no thin plate which was introduced. So we took a random observation point capital P, and the light was reaching from S1 and the light from S2 was also reaching at this capital point P, and the distance between the two slits was small d, and the distance of this observation point from the center of the screen was equal to yn. The formula for the difference between S2P distance minus S1P distance, it came approximately equal to D by capital D, capital D is the same, the distance between the source and the screen, times YN. YN is the shift, or the, this is the distance of the capital point P or the observation from the center of the screen. Now we are talking about O prime. We are not talking about capital P. Now we are talking about O prime point. So in this case, we will just interchange capital P with O prime. Therefore, we will get S2 O prime. We will just get S2 O prime minus S1 O prime will be approximately equal to D by capital D times the position of O prime from the central fringe, that is this distance, that is given by O prime. This is the distance given by O O prime. So we want to find this particular distance, that is the central fringe, it will shift by how much amount from the center of the screen when a thin plate is introduced in the path of one of the light rays. So we will use this formula that we derived in the article of Young's double slit experiment, and replacing capital P with capital O prime. We will get S2O prime, S2O prime minus S1O prime, that will be approximately equal to small d by capital D times the position of the point from the center of the screen. Now we are talking about O prime, so its distance from the center of the screen is taken as capital O and capital O prime. So this will be the difference between the two geometrical paths. Now we have two equations, that is S2O prime minus S1O prime will be equal to n minus 1 times d, and S2O prime minus S1O prime is equal to small d by capital D times the distance of O prime from the center of the screen, that is OO prime. So now we will equate these two equations, because the left hand side of both equations is the same. So we will equate these two equations and we will get n minus 1 times t will be equal to small d by capital D times OO prime. So OO prime is the shift of the central fringe from the center of the screen. So we can, in some books it is denoted by delta. So we are introducing another variable delta, which is the shift of the central fringe from the center of the screen when a thin plate is introduced in the path of one of the light sources. So delta from here will be equal to capital D times n minus 1 times d divided by small d. So this is the result that we get. Now we can find the shift in the central fringe because we have because in laboratories we do have a traveling microscope. So when first of all you will find the center of the screen using this traveling microscope, and then on the introduction of a thin plate the central fringe will get shifted to another point. Let's say it will get shifted to this particular point, and this difference between the two points, it can be calculated using this traveling microscope because it has a scale which is attached to it. So you can easily measure the shift in the central fringe from the center of the screen. Hence delta, it can be found experimentally. Capital D is the distance between the slits and the screen, so this can also be easily found. Then small d, which is the distance between the two slits, is also known to us. Now if you know the thickness of this, if you know its thickness, the thickness of this plate, then you can find small n using this formula, because all other variables are known to you and you also know the thickness of this thin plate. So the refractive index of this particular material, it can be easily found using this formula. Or if you know the refractive index of this particular material, that is, you know this is made up of glass or it is made up of another material, so you know the refractive index and you do not know the thickness of this thin plate. So using this particular formula you can find either the refractive index if the thickness is known to you, or you can find the thickness if the refractive index of the material is known to you. Next topic is interference with white light. So till now we have done the interference pattern which is observed on the screen with the help of a monochromatic light, that is a light which is made up of only a single wavelength, that is it has only single wavelength component. So till now we have done the interference of such kind of light, that is monochromatic light. Now in this article we will be discussing what will be the pattern or what will be the nature of interference if the slits, they are illuminated with the white light. Now what is white light? You know the very good example of white light is sunlight. So we are taking over here source capital S, which is a white light source, and it can be taken as direct sunlight. Now white light, it is composed of seven components. White light, it is composed of 7 components and those 7 components are given by Wibgeor, that is violet, indigo, blue light, green, yellow, orange and red light. So these 7 components and the wavelength of these 7 components, it ranges from 400 nanometer, approximately 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer, where the violet light, it has the wavelength around 400 nanometer and the red light, it has wavelength of around 700 nanometer, and all other components, that is IBGYO, all the other components, they lie within this wavelength range. Now you can clearly see the wavelength of violet is less as compared to the red. Now what is the nature of the interference pattern which is observed with the help of white light? So the central fringe which is observed, the central fringe which is observed at the center of the screen, it will be pure white in color, and this is because the all the wavelengths, that is all the 7 wavelengths of the white light, they will interfere constructively at point capital O. And the reason of this particular point is that if we take point capital O, we know that this point capital O is the center of the screen and it is at an equal distance from S1 and S2, that is S1O is equal to S2O, which means that the path difference between the two light rays will be equal to 0 at point capital O. So the all the wavelengths, all the 7 components which are reaching at point capital O, now they all will have a path difference equal to 0, and hence all the components, all the 7 components will interfere constructively. So we will get a bright spot for the case of violet, and we will also get a bright spot for indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange and red. So all these 7 components will interfere constructively at this particular point. So superposition of all those 7 components will appear to be a single white in color, because when these all components, 7 components, they interfere with each other, or they all appear to be white in color. So this central fringe will be just white in color because of the superposition of all the components, because all the components, they interfere constructively at this particular point. Now what happens when we move away from the central point or the center of the screen? So when we move away, that is slightly below or above the point capital O, the fringes, they start to appear or they start to become colored. Now at point capital O, we will just have a white spot, and away from the screen we will start getting the colored fringes. Now let's say we take an example, we take any observation point which is capital P. Now this is a random observation point capital P, which is taken slightly close to the central point capital O. Now at point capital P, we know that the path difference is given by S2P minus S1P, that is the path difference of the lights which are reaching at point capital O, will be approximately equal to yn small d by capital D. This we have already done in Young's double slit experiment, that the path difference between the two lights at any random observation point capital P is given by the position of that point from the center of the distance of this observation point from the center of the screen, which is yn, times small d, which is the distance between the two slits, divided by capital D, which is the distance between the slits and the screen. So the path difference is given by this formula. Now at point capital P, which is very close to the central point, if the path difference is equal to n lambda, if this path difference is equal to n lambda, we will get a bright fringe, that is the light will interfere constructively.